Cup competition was sponsored by SAB. Shishlili got to the final of all places, and you know that was a third division side. And then in 1997, Kobus van der Westhuizen's former Springbok scored the winning try for the HS Old Boys, which is now Varsity College. So there have been some very exciting times in this tournament. And after 125 years, we can only say thank you to Castle Lager, to South African Breweries, to Fidelity Security, and of course now to Kia, who are now sponsoring the motor vehicle for club rugby, the heartbeat of the game.
Just over the years, you've seen many games and many moments. Is there one memorable moment that stands out for you in this Castle Murray Cup itself?
Well, one of the greatest memories for me was in 2008, against all odds, the Rhinos, Zululand Rhinos, winning the cup for the first time in their 93-year history. That was very special for me.
And now we've got 2015 final, we've got Crusaders versus College Rovers. What are you expecting for that game?
Well, that could go either way. You know, last year, Toti finished fourth. This year, Crusaders finished fourth. And you know, finals are very different games, and it could go either way. But you have to lean towards Rovers to take this one. They seem to hit their steps right at the right time.
Let's zoom in on the Johnston College Rovers team, first of all. Give me a read on that team.
Well, you know, they've only reached their straps now, and what amazes me is they've come good in the last few weeks, and their performance against Durban Collegians, SA Home Loans Durban Collegians last week was absolutely amazing. But, you know, finals are a different category altogether. It's a different game. If you look at Toti last year, they were fourth in the Premier, and then they actually came through to beat VC. Now, I'm not saying that the same is going to happen because Crusaders finished fourth this year. But anything can happen in a final. We have to understand that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Okay, so let's go through that that Rovers lineup. As you said, they came blitzing through at the right stage in the tournament. Where's the strength in that team?
Well, I would say is the flair of the back line. Okay. But I don't want to tell Crusaders that.
Oh, you just have, Joss. You just have.
No, but the Crusaders have got a nice the loose trio.
Yeah.
But something tells me that this game could go either way. But only time will tell. But I do want to thank South African Breweries, and I'd like to welcome Kia. I'm Schlange Kia on board. They are now going to be sponsoring a vehicle, and they're going to be now, I'm Schlange Kia will be driving club rugby, the heartbeat of the game in South Africa.
Yeah, and if anybody had any doubt about club rugby being alive and well, I mean, just have a look at the crowd gathered here and the buzz that's going on around club rugby. It's top notch.
It's unbelievable, and you know, I just wish every weekend was like this. You know, I've got a huge passion for club rugby, and I know it is the heartbeat of the game, and I can tell you now, Saru have got to learn one thing. They've got to look after the game at grassroots, and if they don't, it's goodbye nurse.
No, you're absolutely right, and if you look at the amount of time and energy being invested in schools rugby at the moment, and then zooming in to what is happening as far as clubs is concerned, it definitely does need attention. But as an occasion like this, a lot of people would see it as the end of the season for a lot of people. The trick is now to continue the momentum.
Well, you know, the Sharks Club 15 now go to Kimberley, and the selectors are here today to see finalise their team. So I'm looking forward to seeing that final team named, and I wish the Sharks Club 15 a very joyous tour and successful tour in Kimberley.
We had a quick look at the results of the games which have been played earlier, and apart from the Drakensberg win, which was a bit of a runaway, all of them were close, and that's got to be a good sign.
Yeah, there was only one runaway victory, and all the other finals were sensational. And the other, I think Drakensberg, the home of Henry Honeyball, I think they're going to win that very comfortably. And I feel very sorry for Shawi because they're fielding not a full-strength side with a lot of the injuries.
Yeah, it's noticeable that every team has got injury issues. They've got players coming back in from injury at the last minute. Injuries are a reality in club rugby.
Yeah, it's one of those unfortunate things. And I look at the Rovers lineup, and I'm delighted to see some of their players coming back from injury. And I just hope all Crusaders players are in place for this wonderful final.
Well, as you know, there's some injury issues over some of the Crusaders players, so we'll talk you through that. Russell Hunt from South African Breweries is with us. I'm going to ask Russ to step onto the field. Joss, thank you. We will chat to you a wee bit later. We will...
May the best team win.
Oh, that sounds ominously like boxing. You've got to love the vibe here, Russ. This is why we do what we do for club rugby.
Absolutely, Dave. I just want to thank everybody for coming out to support club rugby. It's absolutely amazing day. We couldn't have ordered the weather better. Just a fantastic occasion. So, really teed up for final of the Castle Murray Cup between two super clubs. And really happy that the people have come out and shown their support.
Yeah, it really is one of the most vibrant club rugby competitions anywhere. If you look at who came through last year, neither of the finalists is in the shake-up this time, but they've all been factors. It's so close and so competitive that it's got to be a good state of health of the game.
You know, that's the thing about knockout rugby and knockout sport. You know, guarantees. You know, you can't play B team. You've got to put your life on the line for 80 minutes, your mates, spectators and your mates. And I think it's really healthy for rugby. Healthy for everyone that's here to support the game.
And club rugby is all about families. People sitting in here have brought kids, mates, it's wives and girlfriends. And I guess we've got a chance to interact with them as well and make them feel important.
You know, every time we get a chance to interact with different consumers, we're really excited. So to have people, you know, of all ages, moms, dads, kids, come out and have a great day in the sun, we're really happy.
Okay, if you've got your phone with you, here's a trick. Tweet. Send a status on Facebook or post on Instagram and just use hashtag CMC2015. And we're busy monitoring all of those and we will direct message you back. And there's some really cool goodies to give away. Beers, ice cold Castle ready for you, Castle Lager goodies and merchandise. And all you have to do is post something on Twitter, on Facebook, on Instagram, hashtag CMC2015, Castle Murray Cup 2015. And I hope your change room is stocked, because once this final is over, we know what happens.
We delivered just over 400 cases of beer yesterday afternoon to Crusaders, so help us clean those stocks out.
Well, it's fantastic. And I must say to the Castle guys, live streaming around the world, the way to go.
So first for us at the Murray Cup, we hope it's a thing of the future. We hope people download, log on and follow us and really enjoy the day.
Okay, you can sense the mood has changed here because the players are out. For a lot of the players that will never get to represent their team at a provincial or a national level, this is going to be a high point. This is as good as it gets.
You know, just amazing to see how much geest there is with these clubs. They score a try, they win their knockout tournament. Their guys are absolutely epic when they win that game. And it's so awesome to see. Culminating in this, you'll see the passion.
Well, passion is what it's all about. Russell, to you and your team, you do an unbelievable job. A lot of it is unsung in the early days of the competition, and we celebrate it on days like this. So big up to you and the guys.
Thank you.
And remember, guys, if you want to win big, just go to Twitter, go to Facebook, go to Instagram, post anything. I mean, what a sight it is here at Crusaders. Post the pictures, post a picture of yourself and your buddies in the stands, and remember, hashtag CMC2015, Castle Murray Cup 2015. So simple, hashtag CMC2015. What happens is the team that is sitting under the gazebo here will monitor them. If they like the pic, if they like your comment, then they could be DMing you back on your phone and saying, come get some ice cold Castle Lager. And you have a problem with that? Didn't think so. Right, the players are warming up. Let's keep an eye on that at the moment. With me at the commentary desk this afternoon is Nick Tatham. And we'll be keeping an eye on those two teams. So we'll have a look through those two teams as we go into the final. And very importantly, we're going to be looking at the benches, because it's a huge factor in club rugby. When you start clearing the benches in the second half, it is often decisive on the outcome of the game. When you look at these two benches, it might just be the game changer here. So hang with us. The players are warming up. We're going to go through those teams in just a moment or two's time.
Murray Cup final, the home side, Nashua Durban Crusaders. They've got Angelo Minetti starting at fullback with Chiocchetti and Zula, who apparently is a gas man. That's a man to watch for this Crusaders side. He scored three tries in the build-up to this final, and he's apparently got a lot of toe. The centres for today are Wade Worthington and Alex Curry. Alex Curry, a man from Queenstown, former Rovers boy, actually, and outside him is Wayne Worthington. Your halfback pairing are Brandon Bailing from the Sharks Academy. He's also played for the UK ZNMP, and his scrum off today is the young Heine Jans van Rensburg, or as he is more affectionately known, Buckies.
It's Buckies, yeah.
Just looking at the forward pack for Crusaders.
The forward pack for Crusaders, number 8, Kirkley Johnson. His flanks are Conrad Mostert and Shannon Carter, who's apparently a man to look out for today. Their loose trio has been on hot form leading up to this final, and so we're going to have to watch them closely, because they're going to have to do a lot of work with the quick Rovers outside backs. second row for Crusaders, they've got Mark Dupreer and Owen McMillan. And in the front row, Monwa Besi Pina, Cohen Wortley, and Rainer Mostert.
Yeah, and a lot of talk about Cohen Wortley, who's apparently a bit of a try machine. Now, he's one of these guys who, just when you need him, is able to crop up in the right place at the right time, run into the gap, run on the right guy's shoulder, burst into the gap, and dot down the five-pointer when it really counts. So he's a bit of a try machine down here, celebrated with heaps of Carlson in the change room afterwards, but apparently one of the guys to watch in this lineup. And then, of course, on the number 11 jersey, Sipo, who got them to that quarterfinal with a try, a regular try scorer, one of the great finishers. So Sipo Zaula is definitely somebody to watch, and their game plan has got to be based around marking those men out wide, because Angelo is a multi-purpose player. He's definitely going to be somebody who's got the diversity to slot into any gaps, and apparently the looser they play it, the more opportunity those guys get. So maybe that's going to be the game plan from the Crusaders guys, keep it kind of loose. But Nick, take us through the Rovers lineup, because it's a very different kettle of fish there.
We have got of names in this Johnson College Rovers side this afternoon. Well, fullback, they've got Quinton Crocker, who's been very solid for them this season. And then on the wing, we've got Dusty Noble. It's a household name in Durban and around in rugby circles, having played for the SA7s as well as being in the Sharks squad. He's a bit of a journeyman, played for Griquas as well and the Lions. The centres for Rovers, the familiar voice of Gareth Jenkinson, our East Coast Radio sportsman. And the captain, Gary Collins, who's played for the Sharks junior sides all the way through. And then
you can hear me.
Took a stint at the University of Johannesburg. The other wing for Rovers today is Matt Phillips. And then they've got a halfback pairing that is one to watch, I think. They've got the evergreen Chris Jordan, who is calling it quits after this. So it could be a phenomenal send-off for him. He's got a couple Super Rugby caps. He's played rugby in Italy. He's been at the Pumas and he's played a lot of rugby in Durban. They've got the youngster Warren Randall starting at 9. It's going to be a battle of the halfbacks today, apparently, with these two youngsters going head to head. The forward pack, Calvin Adam, starting at number 8. He's another man who's played a lot of rugby in Durban. He's Maritzburg College old boy. He's played Craven Week and he's been at Rovers for a long time. And he's going to have on the side of the scrum Wade Elliott and Mesuli Ngwango as his flanks, with the locks, apparently, we have been told, are the men to watch out for this Rovers side, Dave.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, if you look at those two packs, apparently that Crusaders back three is going to be the strong point. And at the same time, this Johnson's College Rovers lock pairing is currently the guys who have got the shoe in for that Sharks Club 15 game. Yeah, so there's certainly a fair amount of interest in that lock combination, and it might just be set pieces that are going to be the key thing. Just for those people that are actually watching and having a look at that list we've got on the screen at the moment, numbers are going to be slightly different in that Rovers backline, because there have been some issues with jerseys, and Quinton Crocker and Dusty Noble are going to be starting in 22 and 21 respectively. Then I'm assuming the guys on the bench are going to be starting in very large numbers. But yeah, and then we take them through into the front row there as well. And again, you talked about the sentiment of Chris Jordan walking out of this team. Chris Kemp is also leaving, heading up country, I believe, to go and take up, whether it's work employment, I'm sure he'll pick up rugby there as well. But Chris Kemp and Chris Jordan are both leaving. So if you ever needed a motivator, that's it, because they should be right there.
Absolutely, Dave. I think both sides have got every bit of motivation for today. I think if we look at the Castle Murray Cup as a spectacle, it is the longest running knockout rugby tournament in the world. And losing semi-finalists, Collegians, have won it 34 occasions. They're the leaders. But the home side, they'll be looking to get one over the Big Sculpt today, I think. This Rovers side is not one to laugh at, with their bench being what it is, with a Springbok on the bench. I guess at club level you can't really get much better than that. They've got Jongi Nokwe on the bench, and the man who scored, I think it was 7 tries against Uruguay for the Boks. That man, what a pleasure to have a man like that on the bench.
You've got to dally just a bit here, because one of the things that Castle does spectacularly on a day like this, the gals, lovely.
Absolutely, as the Rovers men run onto the field, led by their captain, This Rovers side has played in the Selsea Community Cup on a number of occasions as the winners of the league here in Durban, but this season they didn't manage to win that with Durban Collegians taking that. But if we look at how these two teams have got into the final, the Crusaders side played Hillcrest in their first round game and they won comfortably 48-8. They then took on Varsity College in the quarterfinals. They just snuck that one 17-15. And then they had a tricky game against Jaguars in the semi-final. The scoreline might have flattened Jaguars a little bit. They got a win of 36-26 in that semi-final. Rovers have had a tricky run into the final as well. They had a walkover in round one with Peter Teef pulling out of the game. Their quarterfinal game they played against the UKZN MP, where they snuck that one 34-30 with the talisman Chris Yordan getting a hat-trick of tries, and then they go on over the old foe in the semi-final, beating Collegians 30-16 with Wade Elliott getting man of the match there. As the two teams are on the field and
fantastic Fossil Auger merchandise and much more. So hashtag CMC2015. Gray McKenzie, John Mallett, Greg Ace, thank you guys. The dignitaries leaving. And it's just about time for us to start the 2015 edition of the Castle Murray Cup. Welcome everybody.
With the formalities out of the way, the two teams are now on the field. Conditions today are beautiful for rugby. A little bit overcast, a little bit cooler today than it could have been. A little breeze blowing across the field. As you look at it, probably from the top right-hand corner of the field of the screen to the bottom left, it's just a slight breeze. It's actually going to be very pleasant for the players. Underfoot, it's beautiful. It's nice and firm underfoot. And I think we're going to expect another cracker of a game here. Both teams, I think, are going to have a real, real crack at each other. And as it's going to be Crusaders to get the game underway. They are playing from left to right on your screens. Our referee for today is Wesley van der Linde. He's going to be the man in charge. He's the man with the whistle. As we prepare to get this Castle Murray Cup final for 2015 underway.
Yeah, and what's very obvious, Nick, is that the nerves are just abundant. You know, for a lot of these players, they actually will never get to represent their province at a national level or play international rugby. So this is as good as it gets, and there's so much at stake. A lot of this is invested in the regions and in the communities, and the players, you can feel, are carrying all that responsibility on the button kickoff. Maybe a tiny knock there, but a ball in the hands of Johnson's College Rovers right now. Just wanting to settle this down, get the ball out of their territory, play the game in the right half of the field. Kick seems to be bounding beautifully, and bounce of the ball. That's exactly the sort of momentum that any team would dream for at the start of a game.
Yeah, the old man Chris Yordan just getting Rovers on the front foot, getting them down into Crusaders territory. First line out of the game. Looks like they're going to a short one with Crusaders. It's interesting, we're going to see Cohen Wortley with the first throw. He finds his jumper beautifully. A little book. Fly off Bailing. Bailing gives it a short one to the inside centre. And they're setting the ball up here. Jans van Rensburg finds Bailing again. Bailing takes it into contact. Well tackled there by the second row of Rovers. He spotted it. He looks up. Does Jans van Rensburg? Another pass. Good two pass there. Set it up just outside their own 22. Rovers plays all over the ball. Penalty. Early penalty, Dave.
Yeah, again, feeling each other's out, and the ability to forage on the ground is going to be key in this game. Certainly, the way we've seen this game play itself out. And again, so much pressure being placed on those Crusaders back three. And Captain Shannon Carter as well is going to be influential when it comes to managing that ball on the ground. So, line out exactly on the halfway line. And again, the early exchange is very much even between these two sides. Small field here at Crusaders, and for a big occasion like this, when you've got all the branding and the jam-packed touchlines, it accentuates just how close you can get to the action. Good solid line out take. Ball's getting whipped out. Warren Randall looking very able first up. Being held up in the midfield now. They'll be looking for quick ball. Looks like somebody's holding in there and the advantage is going their way. Yep, going to be penalty going the way of Rovers. And what do you do right now? It's on the button here. Do you go for early points? It's a long range. Has somebody got the radar there? Chris Yordan's the man of the boot.
If anything, they've got the breeze at their back early on. But it looks like they're going to look for touch.
Yeah, that's great. I've just noticed they've changed the jersey. Number 2 and 3 just popped around as well.
It's a great touch founder from Chris Jordan to set up the lineout on the 22 of Crusaders. The tight head prop for overs is throwing in, so that is Jarrett Crouch. No, apologies. Chris Kemp is just in the number 3 jersey and he'll be throwing into the lineout. Gets up, great throw. He finds his number 7 there. Wade Elliott on the front foot here, Rovers. Crocker taking it in. Quick ball, Jordan. Jordan, great offload to his skipper, Jenkinson. That's the opening score. Matt Phillips getting over in the corner for Johnson College Rovers. It just looked a bit too easy there for Rovers. They crashed it up off the line out, set up another phase, and then they just had extra men out wide, and it was an easy run-in for Phillips in the end.
Yeah, and it was the quick ball that set it up as well. I mean, that's going to expose the chinks in the defence, and they'll be very heartened by that. You know, they've got such an able back line there with Dusty Noble and Quinton Crocker on the outside, who are also going to be sniping at all of those gaps. So, club rugby, got to love it, the jersey issues. Quinton Crocker starting off with the kicking duties now. Man who's been having an interesting couple of weeks, couple of months playing rugby in Taiwan, of all places. The game of rugby rooting in Taiwan, it's not exactly a prosperous professional career out there, but you're doing two things. You're earning a little bit of cash, but you're also playing a very important part in establishing the game here. So the right boot of Quinton Crocker, about 3 meters in, he set it up about 3 or 4 meters outside the 22. Let's see if he can convert that opening score, 5-pointer into a 7-pointer, and get that Johnson's College Rover bid. And he's curled it in beautifully. It's hanging in the air and it's bang, straight through the middle. It's a 7-pointer. So happy days, Matt Phillips, conversion from Quinton Crocker, and it's a 7-point lead for Johnson College Rovers. Dream start for them. One of the very successful clubs in the KZN and Durban rugby scene in recent years. And two very contrasting clubs, actually. One relatively young, one with a fantastically long pedigree. But Rovers have certainly been on top of the game over the last couple of seasons, and that'll do their confidence a ton of good. So the kickoff men from Bailing. This one goes deep. It's landing just outside the 22. Straight back into the hands of the flyhalf, and he puts that straight down on top of our monitor, which is world-class accuracy. Got to love every moment of this. So the line-out, just a meter or two inside the Rovers half of the field.
Nearly got my head taken off by a rugby ball.
Love it.
Wortley to feed the line-out for Crusaders. They've gone with another short one. They've got the captain, Carter, standing at scrum half. Oh, it's gone straight over the back to Carter. He takes a short one. Gives it off to his number 7 flank partner, Conrad Mostert, who crashes into Chris Jordan. Buckies at scrum off. There we go, another one inside to Wortley. Wortley's met solidly by Calvin Adam in the tackle. And he's been driven backwards, but Crusaders getting over the ball. They're getting men, and it's slow ball now. Slow ball for them, the ball's there. Jansen van Rensburg digs. Bailing's deep in the pocket here. Gives a skip pass. The cutout. Taken in there by Crusaders. They set up another phase here. Patient build up here for Crusaders. There they go. Carter didn't really know what he was going to do with it. There we go. They're giving it to the number 8. That's Johnson. Johnson takes it in. Good cleaning. Better cleaning from Crusaders. But Calvin Adam has got himself all over the ball. And that's a penalty. The ref has deemed that to be illegal. And Crusaders will have a penalty just inside the Rovers half.
Yeah, sealing it off there, and you've got to go for poles here, I should imagine, or they kick for the corners. You're going to see a lot of the attitude towards the two sides evident from these early exchanges. Yeah, it looks like, no, he's going to go for poles. So Buckies has become something of a legend around here. Buckies, you think immediately of Buckies Boerten, you think of the elder statesman of South African rugby. This guy's 19. He's 19, he should be playing under 20s. But he's literally zoomed from zero to hero. He got a start off the bench in the quarterfinal. And was the hero on the night, managed to see Crusaders through that quarterfinal, and is now very much, and the fact you've now got Bailing and Buckies who are able with the boot, and it looks like Buckies, who's the smaller man and the younger man, is opting for the longer kick. Here, this is a long ask, bangs it,
brilliant try.
He's hit it beautifully and just pushed it right to the right hand upright, so the points go begging for Crusaders, but as a statement of intent, they've certainly played their way right back into this game, and Bucky's, as I said, is a man who's, like so many of the players, is actually carrying niggles and injuries at this late stage in the knockout competition. A lot of the club players who are trying to balance professional careers with their passion for club rugby are carrying injuries. Some of them have been raced back in with injuries, and Bucky's is one of them who's carrying a niggle. So let's hope that he sees out the full time for this Crusaders team.
Restart's gone deep from Rovers. Crusaders is giving a bit of air. Looks like they might have found a bit of space. That's Bucky's. He's got the ball in hand. He's running into the 22. Great little switch there for his number 14 winger.
Alex Curry.
And they set it up. They're just a couple meters out here, probably about 6 or 7 meters out. They recycle it again. A pick and go. Pick and go. Bucky's once. Bucky's gets bailing. Bailing to his captain, Carter. Carter to the hooker, Wortley. He's taken in a great tackle there by the Crusaders, the Rovers flank. I beg your pardon. They set it up again. Bucky's is digging here. They look like they're going to go the blind side. But they've lost the ball. But there's no advantage here. Yeah. Referee Van der Linde has seen an infringement. I think it was offsides from the Rovers players. And it looks like it's going to be a fairly simple shot at goal here for Jansen van Rensburg. But it...
Yeah, they certainly made the hard yards. And again, Bucky's is turning out to be a talisman for this team. He's turning out to be quite a playmaker. Got two contrasting scrum halves here. They're both youngsters. Warren Randall playing a very traditional service role. And Bucky's, who is sniping around the fringes and has already caused a fair amount of havoc. The little inside pass to Alex Curry was an absolute beaut there, and that can win games like this. So this should be a real formality. This is bang in front, and that should at least open the account for Crusaders. Nashua Durban Crusaders opening their account in this Castle Murray Cup final.
And he's done it. He's got Crusaders onto the board. Jans van Rensburg from straight in front. That's a 7-3 lead to Johnson College Rovers.
Just a reminder, everybody, if you're using your social media, hashtag CMC2015, post a picture of this late place, post anything, you can see you're winning some fantastic Castle Murray merchandise. So Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, you name it, hashtag CMC.
Crocker gets the game going again. He goes... Great take. Oh, he's dropped it. He's knocked it on. It's been a shambles there for Crusaders. Adam picks up. He's driving hard. Good leg drive from the number 8. Sets it up. This is big pressure here for Crusaders. They've got to hold out here. They can't concede after just scoring. There we go. The ball goes wide. Jordan hits a line. Jordan sees a space. The old man gets in for the score. He saw a little space on the outside. He was up against a forward. And... he just sneaks outside the defender, and he goes over for the second try for College Rovers.
Gee, well, this is always going to be a contest between two talented backlines, and it's certainly boasting every bit of that at the moment. Jordan, hands, skills, pace, gap. And just as important, Gary Collins was the guy that ran into that space, drew the extra player, and allowed... Chris Jordan to come around the outside and then just walk straight through. You've got no doubt part of the chatter that's going on behind the try line at the moment while we set up for the conversion is you cannot afford those defensive lapses. That was a simple overlap move, and it worked like an absolute treat. Could this be Chris Jordan's day? Is this going to be the dream farewell for the man who's moving on after a long career here with Rovers? So who's there with the ball? It's Crocker who's got the kick teed up for the conversion. He's given himself a fair bit of distance on this. It's about 7 or 8 in from the right-hand touchline. Nice deliberate setup. He's put it up nice and high. It's coming down from the stratosphere, but it's gone right. He's pushed it wide. So he's not going to be able to add to that, but it's 2-0. It's 12-3. It's Johnson College Rovers who've now taken an early lead, and certainly looking full value to that. So time for them to bounce back. Chris Jordan, one of the two Chris's who are going to be leaving the team, and part of the sentimental motivation. Chris Jordan, man who's played for Pumas, he's played for the Sharks before, and he's been a pivotal character when it's come to this Rovers lineup, calling it quits at the end of the season. So they would love to reward his service. Oh, a little knock on there, just outside the 22. Ah, little slip. So, advantage Crusaders.
That's two kickoff mistakes we've seen in succession now. Can Crusaders do what Rovers did and benefit from this field position after the error? They got points, did all the hard yards to get those points, and then conceded 5. So it was a bit of a disappointing turnaround, but now they're on the front foot, just outside the 22. They got a blind side to work with here. They're probably about 17 meters in from the right-hand touchline and just on the 22. It's a strong scrum from Rovers, but it's gone up. It's gone up. Dave, if I'm not mistaken, that's the first scrum we've seen today.
Yeah, it is a first scrum, and just as well that the ref blew that, because Randall was almost certainly about to concede the penalty for coming in hot on his opposite number at 9. Good to see the Crusaders Travelling Supporters Club here really producing the goods, because, yeah, it's home ground advantage for these guys. If you look at it on paper, they would possibly like to go into this as the underdogs, but with the home ground advantage and with such vocal support from the pack stands here at Northwood Crusaders, they've got to use that to the absolute max. So a reset of the scrum. Ball goes in, pops out, and it's a penalty, Crusaders. Yeah. Opportunity here. Oh, and a little bit of niggle, a bit of... Yeah, luckily the pushing and shoving is going with a bit of a chuckle as well, and yeah, no hesitation from Buckies. He's pointed to the pole, so they're going to try and add another 3 points to that. Anything to read out of that first scrum?
It just seemed like the loose head four overs. Jared Crouch was just going in at the scrum, wasn't really taking the pressure. So he's given away an early penalty at scrum time, which is going to be a little bit worrying for Rovers. But that first reset scrum was really strong of theirs. Jens van Rensburg glides up the kick just outside the 22. It's a good strike. And that's 3 points. So that is 12-6. Jens van Rensburg's boot being the only point scoring for Crusaders. Crusaders are going to be under pressure at this restart. They missed the last one and that cost them 5 points. So it's going to be important that they take this one and get out of their own half as quickly and as effectively as they possibly can. 12-6 to Rovers as Crocker gets ready to restart the game. The kick's gone deep. Name's on it. Running straight back into traffic, but he's done beautifully well as the inside centre. Alex Curry for Crusaders sets it up for Jens van Rensburg just outside the 22. Bailey with the hoof. Has that gone out on the full? Was that taken back? Oh, that's a brilliantly weighted kick. Then he got taken out by rugby ball again. That's a brilliant kick. It's landed probably 2 inches from the touchline. It's going to be a line out to two Rovers on the 10 metre line of Crusaders. It's a good exit play from them considering what happened in the last kickoff.
Yeah, Bailey's certainly establishing himself. It must be a little intimidating to size up somebody like Chris Jordan as your opposite number, but certainly looking very confident and kicking with the ball out of hand very well indeed. It's a four-man line out now. It's going right to the back. Beautifully taken. Quick ball. Randall feeding Chris Jordan. And of course the four-man lineup means you've got runners up front, so they set this up right in the middle of the field and they're getting the penalty for not rolling away, sealing off. So this is on the 10, dead in front, currently leading by 12-6. And Chris Jordan's got the ball in hand, he's kicking for the corner flag. Great statement of intent here from the Rovers guys. Let's see what Jordan can do with this. He's going to put it out on the 22. Not that generous with the yardage he's won for his forwards, but he has set up a great attacking lineout, and it is on the 22. So 12-6 lead for Johnson College Rovers, and an opportunity to set up an attacking lineup now. Let's see what they've worked out on the training ground. Chris Kemper, the ball in hand now. They've set up a full lineout. Call coming from Warren Randall. Chris Jordan marshalling his back line. Let's see what they've got. Seven comes to the front. Wade Elliott. Oh, it goes through his hands and it's spilt it. They've conceded that, overcomplicated it. And Owen McMullen was the man who managed to come away with the ball. So, consolation ball for Crusaders. Poached in the lineout. They hoof that downfield. It's not going to make touch. Goes straight into the hands of the fullback. So Quinton Crocker takes it into touch. He's going to carry it into touch, which is going to make the Crusaders put in at the lineout.
It was a fairly good kick chase there from Crusaders after Curry decided to put it onto the hoof. He kicked it through and it was a good kick chase. Crocker tried to take them on, but it was a good bit of defending. It's Wortley to feed. It looks like they're going to go with one man out of this lineout. It looks like McMillan is one of their go-tos at lineout time. The Rovers locks, as we know, are in the Sharks Club 15. Paul Bester and Dumani Tlotla. Oh, it's been poached there by Rovers. Oh, Johnson with a good tackle there on Warren on Warren Randall. There we go. Ball up to number 7. Wade Elliott crashing in hard. They set it up. Mwango, he's been a go-to for them so far this game. And Elliott again with the carry. They set the ball up just short of the 10-meter line in Crusaders' half. Randall's complaining to the referee, and they've got advantage now. You're done. Oh, that's drifted a bit forward. It's time off here. I think Van der Linde's had enough of the Crusaders boys not getting out of there at ruck time. He's going to his pocket. What do we have here? We've got a yellow. And it is Conrad Mostert, by the looks of things, who's going to be spending 10 minutes in the bin. Yep, he's coming to the side of the field. Oh, there was a push. It was a late push, I think, from Mostert. And referee Van der Linde just stamping his authority on this game. And as Crocker lines up the kick for the corner, Rovers not taking points on offer. And it doesn't look like he's found touch either. That is Zoula. He has got a lot of pace, but he opts to go to the hoof. That's not a bad kick. Good pass, Jordan. Jordan with a little bit of space here. What is he going to do? He gives it wide. Was it a forward pass? No, it doesn't look like it. As Matt Phillips takes it in, sets it up. Dos Santos looking to take it. Dos Santos giving it wide. There's Kemp. Kemp, the big man, take it in. He wasn't held. Gets up and goes again. They set the ball up. A couple meters short of the 22. Jordan, that's not a good pass, but he takes it well. There, Jenkinson crashing it up nicely. Sealing off. There we go, Randall again. He's scragged in the tackle. They set it up again. They got to use it. There we go. The ball goes to Bester. Bester's met well in the tackle. Is he held up? No, he's managed to get it to ground and get it back. Randall again. He's looking. He's got some runners outside him. It looks like Dos Santos is outside him. But they opt to go for... There we go. Inside center. There we go. Gary Collins taking it in. Oh, Jenkinson's found... Crocker's found a bit of space. Jordan! No ball! Oh, he's tackled into touch. Forward pass in the end, but it was a good slick bit of hands there from the College Rovers.
Yeah, and looking for Dusty Noble on the outside. You know, with Quinton Crocker and Dusty Noble's flair for exploiting the ball in the deconstructed phases of the game and having plenty of toe to boast, it's an opportunity for them to look at that quick ball. And we've seen Chris Jordan doing that quite a bit, where he's had the opportunity to look for the skip pass and literally feed it straight to the wing. It's looked dangerous. They're very keen on two things we've seen. One is rushing up very quickly on defense, and it's worked very effectively to snuff out some of the Crusaders' attack. And secondly, looking for that really flat skip pass, and Chris Jordan's got the length on that pass to make it a reality. So a bit of a breather in the game right now. Part of the fun, by the way, with this Castle Murray Cup final for people sitting wherever in the world watching this is that we can engage on social media around it as well. And you can use hashtag CMC2015, whether you are tweeting or posting a status on Facebook or using Instagram or whatever. Just use hashtag CMC2015. For people in the stadium here, there's an opportunity to win some prizes as well, because we're drawing winners at random throughout the day. Really cool posts or really cool photographs, and some really good photographs of friends sitting in the stands here with an ice cold castle in their hand. Just enjoying what is a magical day. Actually, couldn't be a better day. You know, spring has arrived in Durban. It's been a very warm, very dry summer, and an absolutely classic day. It's sort of hazy and overcast. There's no humidity to speak of. Temperatures are not that high. And an absolute belter of a day for this Castle Murray Cup final. So, Scrum just about to reset. They're on the 22, about 7 or 8 metres in from the right-hand touchline, from the open stand touchline, facing the Crusaders field too. And it's a super strong Crusaders scrum being managed. Crusaders certainly putting the pressure on them, but the boot is coming from Bailing, looking the left boot, and he doesn't find touch. So the ball gets whipped back inside. Opportunity for Rovers to counter-attack now, looking to straighten it up. Matt Phillips looking on the outside, but it doesn't go his way. Gareth Jenkinson foraging, probing, looking for gaps. Mwango again carrying the ball up brilliantly in the middle. Opportunities now going down the right. Chris Jordan feeding down the right. Chris Jordan gets the ball, bounces off its chest, came off his hands as well. So the knock-on ending that move, but they were on advantage anyhow. So a penalty going the way of Johnson College Rovers on the 22. And this one also basically slap in front of the sticks. So do they try and take the game away? Or do they take the consolation 3 points, which would be a formality for somebody of Chris Jordan's standing?
It's been interesting so far seeing that Rovers have opted to go for the corner on every occasion that they've had a penalty. We'll see what they do here. They've coughed up a few lineouts from those penalties, which means they've probably missed out on about 9 points, I would say. So it looks like your Don's going to go for the corner again. Penalty for a high tackle. They do have an extra man at the scrum with the yellow card for Conrad Mostert, but they opt to go and an extra man at the lineout. So we might see a driving maul here. I'm not too sure. It's inside the 22. They got an extra man in the forward pack. It could be an option for them.
Yeah, well, the last move they tried to pull off a lineout, they butchered and surrendered possession on an overcomplicated four-man lineout. Well, they've gone back to a conventional lineout now, and I'm sure they're going to go back to a basics 2 and 4. Jonga Nokwe is now on the field, coming off cheapest. They talk about now the super bench that Rovers has brought into this final. Jonga Nokwe is on the field, and again, the opportunities in the back line suddenly multiply. Let's see if and they butchered it again. Second time they've gone and blown a move off the set phase in the lineout. And ball flies over the back. Tap, tap. It's a real mess. It's a bit of a zoo. Eventually, Ref Van der Linde blows his whistle and is going to award a scrum to Crusaders on the 22. Slap in the middle of the field.
It's the old adage, Dave. We always ask questions about when you're on the attack, why do you go to the back of the line? I don't know, it's going to give you more options if you want to run it to the back line, but if you've got an extra man in the forwards, why not go to something a little bit more simple and actually rumble it up? We haven't seen a driving maul yet. But scrum time now. Crusaders under a lot of pressure at scrum with that one man down. It's been a tight head. They go down the blind side. Jenkinson with a step. Good tackle. He's met well. Sets a ball up in the 22. They go to the blind side again. Mwango, he's been running hard today. Takes it in again. Well set up. Randall gives a short ball to his lock, Glutler. Takes it in. Sets it up again. Randall again. Jordan. Jenkinson's found a bit of space on the outside. Nokwe! He's in for the try. Another one for Rovers. Just showing off the speed that this man has. He didn't score 7 test tries against Uruguay for nothing. And he just showed a clean pair of heels to get outside his defender and get over. That's the second try that Rovers have managed to score on this left-hand side for them. It's going to be a bit of a worrying fact for the Crusaders boys as we have 15 minutes left in the first half. Just they've been able to find that little bit of space. They've two pass, and then they've slipped the defender on the outside. They're using the width of the field well, and Crusaders are getting drawn into defending, which is going to be a massive problem for them, especially going into the second half where the game's going to open up a little bit. And if Rovers can keep using the width of the field, I don't really see Crusaders able to defend it.
Yeah, 100% right. Some serious soul searching going on behind the try line at the moment. It's good to hear the crowd chanting USA, USA, USA. Paul Bester's just come back from the States, so I'm sure his mates will talk to him with broad Texan accents after a couple of castles in the pub, but it's clearly a tag that he's going to carry for a long time to come. There's Quinton Crocker, who's got the kicking responsibilities once again. 5 metres in, he set it up 4 or 5 outside the 22. He's a right footer, so he curled the last one in beautifully, coming in right into the centre between the sticks. So 17-6 the situation right now. Can he convert this to 19? No, he's pushed that a fraction right. It's just going to kiss the right hand upright as it cruises just wide. So remains 17-6. Sitting pretty, Johnson College Rovers.
Crocker's teammates haven't really given much of a chance. He's had 3 very difficult kicks, all from the corner, 2 from the left and 1 from the right. But the first one he managed to curl around nicely. That one just not coming around enough as Jans van Rensburg gets us going again. Mwango gets up there. Johnson also gets up there, but it looks like he's knocked it on. It's advantage to Rovers as they set the ball up just outside their 22. It's a bit scrappy. Mwango takes it in again. He's been running hard today. We said that on a number of occasions. They set it up there. Randall looking for runners. Looks like Dos Santos. Dos Santos takes it in nicely. Breaks the first tackle. Tackled by Wortley eventually. Randall, Jordan. Jordan puts it on the hoof. Kicks for a bit of territory here. It's a great kick from Jordan. Bounces infield. Bounces a little bit strangely as Jansen van Rensburg takes it in. He looks to go the blind side. And he passes it straight into touch.
Gee. there's a lot of banter in the pub afterwards, particularly from the forwards towards the backs, and how unforgiving they are for the backs producing forward passes. And Bucky's just short of ideas. Ball bounced awkwardly, yes, but an opportunity like that, he had an opportunity to take the ball up and run back towards his support. And instead, the ball was batted around like a bit of volleyball, and one of those eventually going forward off Bucky's hand. So it's going to be a line out to Rovers. Let's see if they can get this one right. And it's the third one that goes wrong. They've put you a third in the red zone. Gee, that's going to be frustrating for their coaching and management. So Conrad Mostert warming up on the Nordicu, ready to go back on. And they've pretty much weathered the storm. I mean, they've leaked one try in the 10 minutes that he's been off the field. And they're in possession, looking to get out of their 22. So Bailing with a kick, bunts it high into the air. It's gain, it's not going to be out. So an opportunity for the counter, and it's a good-looking counter down the right-hand touchline. Gets brought down there, but looking for quick ball right now. Randall's got the ball, whips it out wide. Wade Elliott in possession once again. And this is a great opportunity. Try time.
Sort of pushing the ball from right to left as he looks at the post. It looks to be his natural angle as he lines up this kick. Crocker's been... He's looking to add another conversion to his list of three that he's kicked, that he's kicked so far. It's a great strike. Straight as a nail from Crocker. Didn't need any help from the wind there. No shape on that one, just straight and true. And that takes the score out to 38 points to 13 with probably about 40 seconds left on the clock.
I mean, bloody hell, Nick, it's a 50-point first half. I mean, spectators are getting full value for their $10 to park on the field here.
Absolutely, and that's what club rugby is all about. Having players who are not shy to give the ball a bit of air, and it might be a bit of a contentious issue, but I don't see the box doing that at the World Cup.
Elliott with the take.
The Rovers boys set it up, and they get a little bit more going here. They've got Paul Best at the back with it as he breaks off the side. Takes it in, tackled well. Off their feet though, Rovers, but they managed to keep the ball. They go, Jordan. That's a knock from Jenkins. From Phillips. They pick it up again. It's not a knock. That's the captain, Gary Collins, taking it in. It's a good counter shove there from Crusaders.
Randall
snipe, taken nicely in the tackle. The ball's there, but they were holding on by the looks of things. Absolutely. That's a great steal. I think that was the captain there for Crusaders, Shandon Carter, who got his mitts on the ball and was able to win them the penalty.
Yeah, absolutely. So just seconds left in this first half, and they're bleeding. They really are bleeding. So Crusaders would love to try and narrow that deficit here. So what are they going to do with this? A bit of a debate going on amongst the seniors in this team. They're going for the corner. See if they can convert this to 7 points. And that, I've got to say, is exactly the thing to do, because they're chasing the game big time. 7 points and 3 points, the difference is huge. And psychologically, if they can go into the shed having crossed the whitewash and realize that they've still got a sniff at this game, then, I mean, that's the only way that they've got any prospect of coming into the second half and being competitive.
Absolutely, Dave. I completely agree with you. As they set up the line-out just on the 22, Wortley's just waiting for the ball as he gets ready to feed the line-out. It's a full line-out by the looks of things. The backs... They've set up with the winger, Zaula, just inside Bailing, and they've lost another one. Another one's gone long, and it looks like Calvin Adam might be in a bit of trouble there. He took a harsh shot there as he went for the ball, but didn't look anything. There wasn't anything in it. As they take it in, Johnson takes it inside the 22. They set up the ruck. Jansen van Rensburg gives it off to the man who was in the bin. That's Mostert. Mostert again. Van Rensburg. That man in 22 is William Reeder. Ball set up again for Jans van Rensburg. Gives it to his captain. Gives it outside to Worthington. Worthington has a go. He had support on the outside. He decided to take it in. And they set it up there for Jans van Rensburg. He looks for his runners. Finds the big man. It's Reiner Mostert. Ball's there for Crusaders. Wortley looks like he's going to pick and go here. Pick and go, not a bad option. He's made some good meters there as Wortley. But Bester trying to get his hands on the ball. Looks like another pick and go. This time it's Owen McMillan. He's taken well. They're just winding down the clock here. This is their last shot at points in this first half.
Yep, and the forwards are doing all the hard work. There's a realization that 7 points here would be absolute gold to them in the context of this match. Willem Reed is sitting on the outside and he's been flagging for the wide ball, but the forwards are determined to rumble it up. They were within seven of the line and they've gradually worked their way backwards. And I'm afraid that's it for the first half because Wesley van der Linde's blown his whistle. Nipping over to the AR to have a quick chat. Let's hope that the little bit of niggle we've seen doesn't become a factor in this game. But that's the half. It's going to be a 38-13 first half that will have beams all over the faces of the Rovers coaching management because five tries, I take it back, Jenkins in at the end of it all. 38-13 and full value for it as well. Engineered and masterminded by Chris Jordan, it must be said. But using the flair that they've got in the outside backs to really good advantage. The one thing that both teams will go into the huddle at halftime and try and sort out has been the misfiring set piece. The scrums have been, we haven't had many scrums, we've had two or three scrums, but the line-out has been a dog show on both sides.
Absolutely, Dave. I think that there could have been a number of more. We could have been sitting on about 45-33 at halftime if the ball had gone to the correct line-out jumpers, if the hookers had been able to find their jumpers. So. But at the halftime break, we've got it's Rovers that lead, and you can say that they've been full value for their lead. They've been able to feed off the mistakes of the Crusaders guys, and they've scored some great tries. Jenkinson's try got a bit lucky with that one, but otherwise from that they've fed off the mistakes and they've worked well together. The backline has been dangerous. The forwards have worked hard and the forwards have run hard, drawn in defenders, and then they've been able to use the space out wide.
We're joined in commentary in the live streaming. Nick Tapers is calling the game against us. DJ Funky Kyle is spinning the tunes down to get green. Gets better as the night goes on, I believe. And an opportunity to watch the glass and the passes.
Give it a break now.
So this one's on, eh?
Yeah.
What is on four?
I didn't see the change.
Yeah. What a... Oh, it's Justin Overton. Oh no, Justin Overton for Johnny Nopper.
And some of the big news from the first half. The Rovers SA7s and Griqua's Sharks and Lions journeyman Dusty Noble had to go off the field and he was replaced by Jongi Nokwe fairly early in the piece, which is a bit disappointing for Johnson College Rovers, but they have the likes of Jongi Nokwe on the bench, which gives them a plethora of talent.
Dishing up more Castle Lager goodies right now. Remember, social media, all you have to do is hashtag CNC2015. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, you name it. So we've got some Castle Lager goodies to give away to John Carrington. John, come down to the Castle Lager gazebo at the halfway line. And you've scooped some Castle Lager goodies. Well done, John. Remember, everybody, you can pass on to all your mates that if you go onto the Castle Murray Cup Facebook and Twitter accounts, you'll find the links to the live stream. So if you've got mates anywhere in the world that have an interest in this Castle Murray Cup final, you pass it on and they can watch the video, listen to the commentary, and genuinely stay in touch with you. Why is such a lack of a life of rugby and rugby all the time?
Sorry, I came to live.
So Nick Tatum sitting with me at the commentary desk as we analyse what has been going well and what has been going not so well. Rovers running in five tries. I mean, we've had more than 50 points in that first half, so there's been plenty of flair. And a lot of those tries have been scored out wide, so the destructive outside backs are turning out to be key for Rovers.
Absolutely, Dave. I think that Rovers have been able to use the width of the field in the first half. They've drawn in a lot of the Crusaders defenders and then been able to use their quicker men out wide. They've scored a couple fortunate tries. They've fed off the mistakes of Crusaders, but that's the side they are. They have the ability to feed off mistakes like that and score points.
Absolutely, and the generalship of Chris Jordan has been very important as well. The decision making is what actually can open a lot of that defence and set up those tries. A lot of people know this is Chris's swan song. I mean, he's on his way out of club rugby and he's certainly having a virtuoso performance. If this is going to be his last appearance in a Castle Murray Cup final, he'll be pleased as punch with it.
Absolutely, he's been pulling the strings for this Rovers side, but they've been on the front foot for a lot of it, so it's made it a lot easier for him. But the experience and the cool head that he has has really, really given them the go forward.
Let's chat to Joss Robson as well. He'll give us a clear and unbiased opinion. Well, let's hope it's unbiased. Joss, give me a read on that first half. 50 points in the first half with Rovers running in five.
Yeah, well, I wasn't actually expecting that, but it's been magnificent rugby from their point of view. And I have to say, Derek Heiberg has proved to me beyond doubt that he is a bloody fine coach. Sorry, I'm swearing. But and he's identified weaknesses and he's identified strengths. And I would say that Rovers are much calmer. Crusaders have got to calm down. They've got to stay focused. Yeah. I think that's the difference between the two sides, to be honest.
Absolutely, and if they can tidy up the first five and get the line out to function properly, then there's even more threat in the second half.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's wonderful to see players like Yongi and Nokwe back at club rugby and to see some of the great legends of the game playing club rugby. I mean, it's wonderful.
And Yongi Nokwe comes straight on as a sub and scores a try. So, okay, just second half, you see more of the same?
Yeah, well, I think Crusaders will come back now. Well, hopefully they'll come back now.
Well, we're looking forward to the second half. Josh, the doyen of club rugby journalism in this neck of the woods. And Josh Robson actually does an unbelievable job keeping up the profile, not only of club rugby and KZN, but the whole ethos of club rugby worldwide. And he chisels away like a terrier at the ankles of anybody that has an interest in rugby to make sure that club rugby has its fair share. So, second half, everybody.
Rovers go a little bit deeper off the kickoff. Taken in there by the number 12. That's Alex Curry. He takes it in nicely. Sets the ball up outside the 22. Jens van Rensburg digs. Finds his fly off bailing. He puts it on the foot. That's a good exit there. Although he's gone straight down the middle of the field. Crocker takes nicely. Sets it up. He goes for the Gary Owen. Goes deep.
And he's chasing.
It's a good chase from him. It's a good take there from... Oh, but he's knocked it on. That's unlucky for Crusaders. Now they're under a bit of pressure here. No advantage. No advantage called there by Ref van der Linde. It's going to be the first set piece of the half. I see that we were just discussing at halftime with Josh Robson that he didn't expect it to be this one-sided in the first half.
Yeah, the coaches, I mean, both of them are respected coaches. Ronnie Ace for Crusaders and Derek Heiberg for Rovers. And I think they'll be a little bit frustrated that some of the basics haven't been working out. The collections from the kickoff and the restarts have been tatty by and large. We've talked a lot about the malfunctioning lineup, particularly on attack. The scrums have been a bit of a debacle. So the basics have perhaps let them down a little bit. And given the talent pool that they've got in here, I think they would have been hoping for the elder statesmen and the cooler heads to make sure that the basics were all working, to build that platform and then try and, you know, create opportunities for the playmakers to cut open the defence. But the scrum is reset. Solid looking Rover scrum, but it's not a solid scrum. Again, the front row goes up and ref Wesley van der Linde having a careful look at that. I don't see many culpable parties there. It just looked like a complete lack of interest in both front rows from contesting that scrum, because they both stood up equally. So it's a reset of that scrum. So Rovers put in. It's on the 10. It's about 15 metres in from the open stand touchline. And it does create an attacking opportunity. The entire Rovers backline is lined up in anticipation. Nokwe, who came on as a substitute and within 5 minutes had already scored. So Chris Jordan with the ball, feeding it out wide. Skip pass is looking. It's not a great pass. And this one's going to go straight into touch, I think. Yeah, it does go straight into touch. And another missed opportunity from a planned set phase move. And I mean, that's what advance ages coaches.
Absolutely. Yeah. But I think we have to remember that it's been a hell of a long season for these guys. And this obviously being the... I don't think motivation is an issue. I think that it's just... I think fatigue might be a bit of a problem. Heading into a game like this, you might find, especially in the second half, that the game is going to get a little bit scrappy. it is gonna open up. But I guess that's where you're gonna find guys like the impressive Matt Phillips on the wing for Crusaders. I mean, for Rovers. He could really come into his own as the game opens up. The scrum's gone down and it's a penalty to Rovers. Funlinus says that the man's going straight in. The tight head prop for Rovers is going straight in on the tight head side. And Rovers are going to take the points here. Well, they're going to go for the points. This is the first time they've actually had a kick at goal from a penalty.
Yeah, so Jarrett Crouch getting pinged on that occasion. Jarrett, one of the twins. There's a real culture of twins in this Johnson's College Rover team. We all know about the Cronier twins, followed hot in the heels by the Dupriers. And now Jarrett, whose twin brother Justin is not playing. He's carrying one of the injuries. We talked about a long season and carrying the niggles through it. So Jarrett Crouch playing through the season while his twin brother Justin is sitting out and conceding the penalty there. So it's an opportunity now for Rovers to extend that. Quinton Crocker, the right boot of that strapped right knee, wear and tear over the season. But he's kicked solidly. He's got plenty of range. Range is never an issue for him. And they've elected to take the points from in the middle. He's just inside 40 metres out. Ball teed up nice and high. This appreciative crowd here at Northwood Crusaders hushing as he tees this one up. See if they can take them into the 40s now. Taking plenty of time. Very deliberate. Hits it hard. Once again, range is not an issue. He's pushed it. The touch judges' flags are unmoved. So the score remains 38-13.
I must apologize to all Tondra Shivanga fans as it's kicked by the inside center, Alex Curry. It's taken in by Yordan. Yordan with a little step and go and puts it on the toe. Worthington tries to flick it back in field. It is still in field, but it looks like it was a knock. It's an option, I think. They've got the option of the lineup or the scrum. I was going back to Tondra Shivanga fans. He was the man who scored 7 tries against Uruguay. It was not John Ginokwe. He, in fact, managed to get 5 against Australia. As Rovers set up the line-out. Kemp to feed. Goes to Bester. It's a scrappy one. Taken in by Randall. Randall to Yordan. Yordan to Ngongwa. Takes it in. Set it up. That's a penalty advantage by the looks of things. Oh, there's a flying arm in there. Flying arm in there from the man who's sitting on a yellow card at the moment, which is a little bit dangerous. Penalty to Rovers, and they're going to go for the corner here by the looks of things. Yordan lining up a kick for the corner. Ngwango has been a serious ball carrier for Rovers today, the number 6 flanker. As Yordan finds touch and he sets up the line out for College Rovers, they're going to want to look to get this ball cleanly. They've battled in the lineouts. I know we've been going on about it, but they really have battled in the lineouts today, both sides. I don't know whether there's a bit of humidity in the air. It's making it a little bit muggy. Ball handling is a little bit tricky for the hookers, but that shouldn't really be a problem at this stage of the season. They've gone for another short lineout. They go to the front. Oh, it's stolen. It's stolen. Ball was in the air, stolen by Crusaders who knock it on. It's an unfortunate mistake there for the men from Northwood Crusaders. They've really done a bit of hard yards at line-out time. They've been able to put the Rovers jumpers under a bit of pressure and then just little errors from them as the scrum to Crusaders. I mean to Rovers inside the 22 of Crusaders. There's no blindside here on the 5-meter line. It looks like they've set up with Yordan with Phillips behind him and then Collins outside him. It's going to be interesting to see what they do. It's a great scrum from Crusaders. Randall to Yordan. Yordan. Oh, Phillips is straight through, but he's tackled beautifully by Crusaders as they all pile in. The ball comes back. That is Wade Elliott takes it in. The ball's in the air by the looks of things. Penalty Crusaders. There's a serious injury, I think, now. It's not looking very good there. I'm not sure who the man is that's down, but Crusaders have been able to defend beautifully and win a penalty on their own try line. This is not looking encouraging. I can't see who the player is that is down. It's a Crusaders player.
opportunity for somebody else to win more costs along the merchandise. Roger,
the medics are on there as quickly as they possibly can, and they will be seeing to the player who's down. I'm not entirely sure who the player is, but they will be sure to get him going, get him up, or hopefully not the case, get him on a stretcher and stabilize him. It's been a really, 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 really tough day for Crusaders. They've battled against this really slick Rovers side. They've made a couple mistakes, made a few errors that have cost them. But they've got a penalty now. They're still playing this game. They really are giving themselves a chance to stem the tide of points coming from Rovers. As we see a change here for Crusaders, on in jersey number 21 is Dion Stowell, who comes onto the field. It's a penalty, as we were saying earlier. It's a penalty to Crusaders, just on their own try line, and they're going to want to clear their lines and just breathe a sigh of relief that they've been able to absorb a bit of pressure and not concede points.
Yeah, and it's a sight that we all really don't want to see at any stage in the game. But the good news is he's about moving, and the hands are all moving, and he's in the hands of the medics here, who do a fantastic job. They literally are, and he's up. Jeez, this is club rugby. He's Mr. Invincible is about to get up and take up his bed and walk, but he would be very wise. I think the ref's not going to allow him, particularly having gone down that heavily. He'd almost certainly have to go in and get checked out for concussion. No, he's not a happy camper at all, and the replacement has already been made, but relief to see that he's in relatively good nick. Medics are going to help him off the field. And again, the pressure is now being placed on this Crusaders bench. And we talked about it earlier, this Rovers bench is loaded with talent, and comparison-wise, the Crusaders team is light. And they've got some youngsters with certainly less experience man for man on that bench. And now the pressure is going to more and more be put on them. So a generous round of applause from the Rovers guys as the medics make their way off the field with the injured player. Penalty being awarded the way of Crusaders, so they have an opportunity to get out of their red zone. Ball's going to be in the hands of Bailing again. He's going to want to try and make some decent yards and get him out of here. So a bit of a stalemate in the second half. Given the flurry of points that were scored in the first, touch finder is very effective. That goes right up into the cheap seats here at Crusaders.
Yeah, it has been a fairly quiet start to the second half compared to how we got going in the first half. The line-out is set up there by Worthington on his left boot. There's a change here for Rovers. It's Lusando Santos coming off, and on goes Matt Jones in his place as Crusaders go to the middle of the line-out. They go to their go-to man there. That's Mark Dupreer. But they go to the blind side. It's another poor decision. But they get the penalty anyway. There was a bit of space there for Jansen van Rensburg down the blind side if Johnson had been able to get that pass to him. But I think he might have overrun it, or the pass wasn't sympathetic enough. It looks like Worthington's going to be the man who's going to be entrusted with finding touch with his left boot. As those changes are starting to come on, we've seen another change there. On in jersey number 19 is your Zimbabwean representative, Simba Bwanya. He's on in jersey number 19, and it looks like Crusaders are getting ready to bring on their number 19. That is Peter Labuschagne. But it looks like he'll come on after the line-out, which is set up just on the Rovers side of halfway. Wortman to feed. Wortley to feed, I beg your pardon. Up goes Johnson. No, it goes right over the back again. It's taken... Wasn't taken cleanly. Apologies by Ngwango, who would have had a really good crack at the Crusaders' backline like he's been doing the whole day.
In the crowd, you're looking to Paul Bester to deliver once again. No pressure on the lad, and the crowd starts heckling you by name or by nickname. So often, when you get to halftime in a game which has been lopsided and has clearly gone in favor of one of the teams, you tend to overthink your crisis. What both teams were doing and producing such an entertaining first half was playing with a lot of carefree abandon and a lot of flair. And we've had a very different sort of strategy from both teams, apart from the fact that a lot of changes have been rung. But they've clearly, they're overthinking their predicament, and it's a monster Rovers scrum. Oh, Scrubbers have won the penalty for it as well. So for the first time, there's total dominance there, committed to that. The second shove from Rovers producing the effect, and ref Wesley van der Linde having a careful look at one of the front rows who's gone down in the process. So it's Cone Wortley there, hooker, who's feeling his sternum at the moment. And that's exactly where the ice is going on at the moment. It's a horrible injury if you get that cartilage separation around your ribs and your sternum. It's really painful and it takes forever to heal as well. So I really hope that that's not the case. Let's hope it's just a bump on the sternum. He went backwards at an absolute rate of knots, man. He was reversed out of there like an Italian tank, man. There was absolutely no price as he got trampled by that Rovers scrum, which for the first time they'll be excited by that, because they have a new weapon in their arsenal. The scrums were a mess in the first half. It really was. Neither of them really functioned and fired properly. But the Rovers scrum is going to be super excited by that, because they smashed them. They owned them well and truly. And when it comes to the next set phase, there's absolutely no harm in looking at that scrum option. So the penalty going the way of Rovers. It's just inside the Crusaders half of the field. And kicking for the corner once again.
It's a good touch finder there by Crocker as he puts play into the 22 of Crusaders. The penalty there, you never enjoy seeing that. You never enjoy seeing the scrum go down and players lie on the ground like that. But it's good to see that Wortley's back and he's in play. As Crusaders go to a full line out here.
Okay.
Full line out. Is Bwanya going to be their new go-to man at the line out? No, it goes to Besta. They set up a maul. This is the first maul we've seen. It's a good counter shove there by Crusaders. Calvin Adam he's controlling it at the back. Calvin Adam still got it at the back. Crusaders are managing to fracture this maul quite nicely. But Adam's calm and... Yes, taken in. It's a scrum to Crusaders. Taken in and not used. There's a few handbags getting thrown around there on the side of the field. Players just sizing each other up and just asking what they're doing after the game. Few handbags, nothing serious. The scrum goes to Crusaders. Rovers needed to use that ball. Adam thought that he was going forward, but the ref really didn't give them a chance. So it's going to be big pressure on the Crusaders scrum here. They've been under pressure in the second half. That last scrum that we saw, this Rovers bench is really starting to flex their muscles here. They've got the replacement prop on, that's Matt Jones, and they've also got Bwanya on in the second row. There's a scrum. That's a huge scrum from Rovers. But Crusaders managed to keep the ball. Oh, no advantage. No advantage. The penalty goes towards Crusaders. Jens van Rensburg potentially looks to take quickly, but no, he decides against it. Scrumming straight up is the call from ref van der Linde, and it's probably not the wrong one. Rovers have got the dominant scrum, but they aren't scrumming straight. They're scrumming up rather than straight, which has led to the penalty, and it doesn't look like Worthington's found touch. That's the first mistake we've seen. It's not a mistake. Crocker having a crack. He gives it to Nokwe on the wing. Nokwe with the show. Steps inside. Tackled well in the end. The ball's on the ground. They're looking to pull for it, were Crusaders. They're spreading out, fanning out. Randall digs. Jordan. Jordan to the new man, Jones. Jones takes it in, goes to ground. Middle of the field. Randall again, Jordan. Jordan puts it on the toe. Well read there by Worthington, who's managed to get back. Oh, but he's butchered it. He's got away nicely. He's done well in the end. It must be said. He made up for his little error, although he got himself into a very good position there. He saw that Jordan was going to put the ball on the foot, and he managed to backtrack and get the ball. He had taken it cleanly and put it out, but he eventually managed to get it off the park. And it's still an attacking line for Rovers.
Absolutely, and the real composure there. Just take a moment to reflect on Bucky's Jansen van Rensburg. I mean, he's a lightie. He's a 19-year-old in this team. He's played with such composure. He's taking decisions along with the seniors when it's come to the strategy of this game. And the players are now turning to him to look for a bit of direction as well. So here's a young man who's got a really, really bright future. I mean, with the injuries staying away from him, I'm really looking forward to seeing what he can do, certainly in the club scene, and maybe even going further, because he's certainly got years on his side. Great, clean takeout. The line-out functioning perfectly this time. Now they're getting in the rumble, but it does seem to be going down to ground, so they're going to have to recycle. This ball is still up. The rolling maul gets a little bit closer. They're about 10 or 12 meters out right now. They've split this one up down onto the side. Glula once again with the ball. This time it gets spread. It's in the hands of Chris Jordan. Chris Jordan looks wide. The ball goes out, and it's in the hands of Crocker.
And that is another try for Johnson College Rovers as Crocker gets his first score to go with his day with the boot. It's another incisive backline move from the men from College Rovers. It's incisive in that it's just well executed. People running good lines, passes being met well, good solid passes being met well, and good lines, good angles there. Crocker hitting that angle beautifully as he just cut inside the defenders, and it was always going to be difficult to defend that situation, especially when you've got to defend a man like Chongi Nokwe out wide, and you've got to make a decision whether you're going for the tackle or you're going to stay on your man. And unfortunately for Crusaders, Crocker had other ideas, and he was really incisive with his line and getting the go forward and getting over for the score. He's looking to convert his tries. The score moves out to 43 points to 13. It's on the 15, just outside the 22, is where he's decided to place this one. It's a reasonable strike, and it's over. That's 45 points to 13 from Crocker. And we see a change here for Rovers with Njapulo Mkize coming onto the field. He's taken the place of Jared Crouch by the looks of things. Crusaders under a bit of pressure, under serious pressure, beg your pardon. They're chasing the game, and it looks like they've got to just try and get their hands on the ball. They really haven't had the ball as Jens van Rensburg gets it going. Taken in there by the ever-present Nwango. Oh, great little dummy there from Randall, who was looking, shaping to box kick, and then decided to, with the presence of a Crusaders defender, decided to take it in. But there's been a knock-on at the ruck there, and it's probably the first time we've seen Crusaders in the half of Rovers, the second half.
And I got to say, this really big crowd here at Northwood Crusaders, a little bit shell-shocked at this stage. This tsunami of points in the first half has abated a little, but it's fairly clear that they're being taught a lesson or two by this Johnson College Rovers team. And it must be said, we've got to start thinking towards that man of the match, John Allen, former Springbok in Scotland and Sharks stalwart hooker, is adjudicating who the man of the match is. And I've got to say right now, that Chris Jordan's generalship at 10 for the Rovers team is turning out to be pivotal. In fact, it's probably the difference between these two teams. Randall waiting for the ball. It's a little bit slow in coming out. So, bailing with the ball. Can they make something out of this? Crusaders now looking to try and narrow that deficit into the hands of Wortley. Carries this one up. They're just outside the 22. Ball goes to ground. They're trying to set this one up. Looking down the open side. Henny Jansen van Rensburg with the ball in hand again, once again. This time it bounces into Bailing's hands. He carries the balls up, sets it up. Buckley's with the ball once again. They've got plenty of runners out wide, but they're simply carrying that ball to set it up, hopefully to try and get Bailing back into position. Willem Rieder, who's been looking for work all afternoon, snapping at the heels. Dion Stowe, who came on late in the second half. And it's Stowe who's got the ball in hand right now, feeds it to Wortley. They've carried the ball to about 15 out. Once again, Bucky's feeding on the inside, making the hard yards here, meter by meter. They're inching closer and closer towards that Rovers line. Feeds the ball wide this time into the hands of Willem Rieder, who's itching to try and show what he can do, and he's coughed it up. Ball's gone forward, and it's an opportunity for Judan to simply bunt that mercilessly into touch, and opportunity wasted.
Definitely, but this College Rovers side have been really, really strong in defence the whole day, and they really haven't given Nashua Crusaders a chance. They've been strong in the tackle, they've been strong in the collision, and they've been able to turn balls over at vital times. Even there, they had two men on the ground receiving attention. I think there was a head clash between the replacement prop in Jabulo Mkize and Calvin Adam. We see a few changes coming on again now. Sanele Sebande is coming on for College Rovers, and there are a couple changes coming on for the Nashua Crusaders side. On in jersey number 17 is Sibusiso Mankwale. Ramorola to feed the line out for Crusaders. He's also throwing it straight over the back. Oh, it's picked up well by Crocker. Oof. It's a solid collision there. They go down the blind side. It's good hands. Phillips goes. Phillips beats one, and he's bundled into touch. It's like a herd of wildebeest coming through here in front of us as he's bundled into touch and sets up the line for Crusaders. Just inside the Rovers half. It wasn't a great start there for Ramarola, although in his defense, as a former hooker, it's normally the jumper's fault. It's very rarely the hooker's fault at line-out time. So he was a bit unfortunate that his jumpers didn't even jump. And just calming it down here as he sets to throw again. A bit of attention there for the Zimbabwean Mwanya. Zramarola feeds, looks to feed. He's gone straight over the back again to his captain, Carter. Carter to Bailing. Bailing takes it in. Haven't seen a lot of passing from Bailing today. Jens van Rensburg again, looks for his short runners. There we go. That's a great incisive run there from Owen McMillan as he sets it up on the 10-meter line. Jens van Rensburg again. He's really had to work for the ball. The presentation hasn't been great from Crusaders. That's to the reserve. Oh, it's a great bump there from Labaskakhni. He takes it in. There we go. Quicker ball. It's taken in by Mostert. Set up again. Jens van Rensburg behind the back of his prop to Labaskakhni again. Another good run from the big man. Is he going to be held up here? He's in the air. Ball's in the air. They've got to go forward. Otherwise, it's going to be a use it or lose it situation. Now to ground. I think if the ball doesn't come out, it's a scrum to Rovers.
Absolutely, and it lost some urgency out of this Crusaders team. The only way to dig themselves out of a big, big hole at the moment is to seize the opportunities. They've got probably 25 minutes left in this game, and they need to use every one of those if they're going to try and give themselves a sniff, or at least come out of there with their heads held high. So Cone Wortley coming off for Crusaders worked really hard, tirelessly. We knew he came in here with a bit of a question mark over him injury-wise, and they were hoping to get him through as much of this match as possible, but they've made the call, and Ramarola having to negotiate a peaceful dispensation with the rest of his teammates here after a bit of a rocky start to the lineouts. So it is a scrum. It's going to be a Rovers put in just outside their own 22. Ref Wesley Funalinda, who's a busy bee. It must be said, these referees cover an awful lot of ground on a day like today. These guys are getting involved in a lot of games, and this ref society, which is producing some really talented officials, has got people running ARs and blowing games throughout the day, and many of them will blow on. And a number of games on a Saturday, and they kept very busy during the season. It's a very fun and fulfilling career, actually, for anybody's ever wanted to get involved in the game and for whatever reason can't play, but has got the time and the willingness to get involved. Then go and have a look at getting involved with your local referee sub-union. Alan Bukas on the field now in 17 for Crusaders. Kick going straight downfield. Oh, and they... two players collide, the ball is bouncing loose, and it's Gareth Jenkinson who is sniffing around here like a hungry Rottweiler looking for an opportunity. Ball is held up at this stage, but again, no communication from the black backline players of the Crusaders about who's going to take that ball, and it nearly cost them. In fact, if Jenkinson had come in steaming any hotter, that would have been straight into his hands and would have been a gift 7-pointer, and that really would have put the game totally and completely out of reach of this Crusaders team. So scrum time, and the Rovers players will be licking their lips. Because remember, the last time they had a set scrum, they were able to completely monster their opposition. So opportunity here, see if they can do the same.
We've got a completely new front row here for Rovers with their last front row change. Royal Mwale coming on for Chris Kemp. So it's going to be interesting to see how they front up against this Crusaders pack. We've been going on about it the whole day that the bench of the Rovers side is considerably stronger. So let's see how they front up. Scrumming before. Ref blows it, pulls him back up. Crusaders have really got to try and get themselves a little bit of ascendancy at the hit, otherwise they're going to go backwards. That's why there was a little bit of early pushing there. So I think if that goes down again, I think we might see a free kick to Rovers. They're not, yeah, because otherwise it's been a case of Crusaders completely on the back foot at scrum time. Back line's lined up to the left. Crocker's now 10 with Chris Jordan off the field. Ball's at the back now. Randall. Crocker. Short ball to Jenkinson. Sets it up. They come right now. They've got numbers here. Crocker. Great ball. Great take. Oh, big contact there as Mwale takes it in. Oh, it looks like the captain's coming in the side of the ruck. It's turnover. It's been turned over. Jones trying to get his hands on the ball, unable to. He's cleared out. Curry looking for a short one by the looks of things. Van Rensburg gives it to McMillan. McMillan takes it in. And he's still in field. Recycles the ball nicely. Curry on a short ball. The inside centre's been running all day. Takes a good short ball. The pick and go there. As they set it up again. They're still in their own half and they're not really making meters. But they've got men on the short side here. If they decide to use it, Lavaskakhni takes it in. He needs to try and get his hands free to get it away. He tries. He's unable to. He sets it up again. That's not a bad option. If it bounces left, it bounces up. Phillips is able to gather it. He's got a clean set of heels, this man. He's not shy to run at the back of the defenders. They set it up just outside. They got the penalty advantage. It's just discipline, discipline, discipline that's lacking from this Crusader side.
And it all went back to Sipa Zaula snaffling the ball when Rovers were on the attack in the Crusaders 22. And it's a great turnover from Zaula that produced 50, 60 meters. But here it comes again. It's like a tilting seesaw. When you start going down, you know that the high side is suddenly in charge. So it's the Rovers side that are pushing into the 22. They're 5 meters out. Long ball this time. Quinton Crocker has got the ball in the fly half position. Boom! Monster hit! Man, that was like a runaway Mack truck coming to meet him. Ref Van der Linde's got his arm out, so they're on advantage. They'll want the quick ball here to take full advantage of it. There he goes, Warren Randall sniffling it up the middle. But it doesn't really work out, so they're going to come back for the penalty. But big hits. It's the staple fodder of club rugby.
It's actually been Conrad Mostert who's put in two massive hits. One on, I think it was on Graham, on Quinton Crocker. And then one now. But it looks like he's on the ground. Could be a bit of cramp there for the flanker who's been fairly industrious since he got his yellow card. But I think he might have just snuck off sides there at that ruck, which means that there's a penalty to Rovers and another opportunity to just extend their lead.
So 10 minutes left in this Castle Murray Cup final here. Opportunities like this are quite welcome. It's not unfamiliar for a team to make a call for somebody to lie down and call the medic so that everybody can catch a breather. But comfortable at this stage, it's 45-13 in the icy control of this Johnston's College Rover team. It looks no sign like they're going to relinquish their grip on this game. More changes coming. Alan Bierkes coming on in jersey 18. No, they wouldn't be. And Bierkes is already on in 17. Both of these teams having a typical club rugby admin with their jerseys and numbers. But interesting that they've got this final done. There's no doubt about this now. And the decision to go for the points right in the middle maybe is a fairly obvious one.
I think going back to our jersey admin, I think it's as Crocker slots the 3 points and takes the lead out to 48 points to 13. I think that we've got Taylor Gentry is on in number 17, I would assume. And Alan Bierkes is coming on now in jersey number 19. For Crusaders. As a familiar sight of Jansen van Rensburg restarting happens and goes deep. Oh, it's a knock there. It's a good chase there from the winger. He hasn't really had a lot of opportunities, has Zaula, but he's really put his body on the line. He's not a big man, but he's really put a lot of effort in today for Crusaders. As they set it up, Lavaskakhni goes down the blind side. He doesn't have any support. Jones getting in there trying to pull for it, but he's unable to get it. Another pick and go. McMillan again. Pops it up to his captain, Bailing, with a step. Show and go. He's done well. Beaten one. Got a great short ball. I didn't see that one. They set it up again on the 22. Do Crusaders. They bundle into the 22 now. The ball's there for Jans van Rensburg. Jans van Rensburg finds his winger. There he goes. Zaula has been looking for work now. But a knock on. They get the ball back. That's McMillan. McMillan gives a short one to the reserve hooker, Ramarola. Takes it in. He keeps the ball well. They managed to recycle the ball here. It's a little bit slow for them as Jansen van Rensburg digs. He's got a few options. Lubbeskach needs his go-to man at the moment. Takes it in. Good defending from Rovers. They're really not allowing Crusaders to get over the gain line at the moment, which is a little bit, it must be very demoralizing for the Durban North side. It's taken in again there. That's the new man, Alan Bierkes. They recycle again. Jansen van Rensburg just slowing the game down, trying to see what he can get out of the situation. They go to the short side. The little grubber through. Oh, it's beaten everyone into touch.
Bailing interests me. He's suddenly becoming invisible in the second half. The principal ball carrying is now being left up to Labuschagne, and that's been very effective. And he's finding some support on his shoulders. But Bailing is now sort of going into extra wing cover in an attacking situation. So as a key decision maker, they're actually having to turn to the forward simply because Bailing is not there at this stage. And that's a complete reflection, inverse reflection on what Chris Jordan is doing at the other end of the field. So they've got time on their side to try and invert that. There's 7 minutes left in this game. They trail by around 30 points, but they are on the attack right now. The line-out ball goes into Rovers. They've got the ball. They're going to decide to run it out of their 22. They make some hard yards. And again, they're going to keep running that ball. Quick hands. Backline players mixing it with the forwards. And there's an opportunity. Great chip and charge down the line. Goes to hand, and it's into the safe hands of the man that we've just been casting aspersions on, Bailing. He's the man who actually manages to turn it around, recycle it, and then make another 10 metres upfield. So, Crusaders with the ball, and there's a knock. Frustrating knock, because there was an opportunity. Numbers were outside. There was a 4-on-2 opportunity, and the knock.
I think it's just been the story of the day for Crusaders. They just haven't been able to build phases and to be as incisive as Rovers have had with ball in hand. They've coughed it up. They've been full value for their efforts, but it just hasn't been their day today, unfortunately. But with just over 6 minutes to go in the game, they've still got a chance to get themselves a bit of pride in, maybe get over for another 5 points. There's been 7 points scored in the second half. I think that might boil down to the fact that it is the end of the season, and these players have been at this for a very, very long time. Scrum goes down. Randall, Crocker, interception! In number 23. Unfortunately, we don't have a 23 on our score sheet, but we can assume that it's probably Dion Stahl who goes in for the try for Crusaders. That is a consolation try. It was an elaborate move that Rovers had planned there, and it just didn't work as he shot through the line and was timed his run beautifully as he got over and snuck in for the try under the sticks. The conversion should be a formality for Jansen van Rensburg, and that should give them another 7-pointer, which will take his score to 45-20. Oh, he's decided to have a drop, and he's slotted it. That's 45-20 with 4 minutes to go in this game. It's a bit of consolation for the men from Durban North. Apologies, that was Willem Reda who got over for the try. In jersey number 23. To much elation from the local crowd who've been sitting through this very, very boldly and loyally, but it's been a tough one for them today, and they the restart from Crocker. Crocker goes deep. Labuschagne coughs it up, unfortunately. It's another knock for Crusaders. The restart has been poor from them. Jongi Nokwe gets a bit of space on the outside.
Oh, here we go.
Inside, outside, but he decides to take contact. Sets it up. That's about 10 metres out on the left-hand side of the field for Rovers. Randall digs. Gets it to Crocker. Crocker, it's overrun there. And it's turnover ball again. That's Bierkes who takes it in.
And making the yards.
Yeah, and making yards as he takes it in. Jansen van Rensburg. Looking for some options here. Goes down the blind side. That's to Rieda. The man who just scored takes it in. It's a penalty to Rovers. Penalty to Rovers. It's just really not going their way today, is it, for Crusaders?
Yeah, and you can see the Crusaders guys are really trying to dig deep. They know the horse is bolted on this one. They're not going to be able to pull it back. What they would really love to do, I mean, Reader's intercept try was some sort of consolation, but they would love to construct something that they can walk out of here and hold their heads high and, you know, finish it on a high, give their home fans here something to really cheer about. But unfortunately, it's Rovers who've gone and kicked for the corner, and they're going to have the attacking line-out. 3 minutes left in this Castle Murray Cup final. And another score is going to take this Rovers tally past the 50 point. And again, that's another mental hurdle that they're not going to have to want to deal with here. If they can hold them out just for 3 minutes and maintain the score. The score has, as compared to the tsunami in the first half, we've had hardly any scoring. It's one converted try in the second stanza. And here we go. Ball goes on the inside. It's a cleverly worked little inside move. And referee Van der Linde is going to have a chat with his ARs. and they've decided that there was a forward pass in that final movement. So all the celebrations amongst the Rovers ranks come to naught, because very calm, deliberate conversation between the ref and his AR to point out that there was a forward pass in that final movement. So it's going to be a scrum, and it's going to be a put in by Crusaders on their own line. And again, the clock ticks down to 2 minutes here. They would love to try and keep the Rovers boys out just for this last stanza here. Since that front row has changed, that demolition scrum that was rampant early on in the second half has not had the same teeth. Ah, take that all back. There it goes. Take that all back. Here comes the Mack truck. Steal yourself, people. This is not going to end well. Oh, and there's a few handbags going on at the back there. Looks like it's try time. Try time indeed. Well, that was a brutal rolling scrum. Any idea who scored that, Nick? It was just this mass of light and dark blue that just, it monstered them. It absolutely, it smashed them.
Absolutely. We were just commenting on the scrum. I think it's a penalty try, actually. It's definitely a penalty try that's been awarded from that scrum. Absolute monster from Rovers. Calvin Adam was holding it at the back. Cheese, as he's affectionately known, was holding it at the back of the scrum. But it just popped out, but I think that there'd been an infringement already from the Crusaders men. And that just sort of sums up the day, doesn't it? It's just been a dominant performance from College Rovers as Crocker lines up the conversion to take the score to 55-20. That's it, 55-20. As we head into what is the last minute of the game, and I think that the men from Durban North are going to want this one to finish as quickly as possible. There's still about 5 minutes left in this game with injuries and all of that. There's still a bit of time for Crusaders to get their consolation as the familiar side of Jans van Rensburg restarting gets us going. They've managed to get the ball back of Rovers. It was another scrappy restart, but they've got the ball back. They're going to have a crack, I guess. Why not? Ball bounces unkindly for Rovers. Well read by Jenkinson. He would have been offsides there. Great hands from the Rovers men. Jenkinson in possession again. Gives it inside to Nokwe. Nokwe tries to beat one. They're keeping the ball alive here, which is brilliant to see. There we go. Randall. Crocker. Crocker gives it to Adam. Adam. Ah, oh, it's not a very sympathetic pass to Sanele Sebande. It's gone back. There's advantage here for the Crusaders. There's a knock on from Rovers. Ball's in the air. So they're going to want to use this one. But it doesn't look like they've got any sort of momentum or any sort of idea of what they want to do with the ball when they got it. And now they've just been monstered off their own ball. The ref's called advantage over as Crocker takes it in. Crocker has a snipe inside ball to Jones. Number 7, there we go. That's Elliot, and it's a knock-on from Rovers. They're really deciding to have an absolute crack towards the end of this one. And they knocked it on, and it's a... And the Crusaders, and that's it. That is the ball game. The Castle Murray Cup for 2015 is heading down the road to College Rovers. It's been an absolutely dominant performance from Johnson College Rovers, who have been full value for their win today. They've defended well, they attacked well, they kicked well. They had a more complete game than the Crusaders side. I think that the men pulling the strings for Rovers were much more influential in this game than the Crusaders guys. I think Jordan, when he was on the field, was able to give them a really good go forward ball and on front football, and they used it well. They had men out wide. Matt Phillips was really good. I think Gary Collins, the skipper, was really solid. With the loss of Dusty Noble, Chongi Nokwe came on and he made an impact from the get-go, and Quinton Crocker, the fullback, was definitely a candidate for man of the match. But the forward pack was really, really solid for Rovers. They really got the go. They gave the back line the opportunity to use the ball, and I think that men like Mesulim Nwango, he was a great ball carrier for them. Really got them on the front foot. And then this unsung heroes, Paul Bester was really good. He gave them as clean a ball as he could at line-out time, and he was really industrious in the loose. So I think that they were full value for their win today, Dave. Who would you say is your man of the match?
I've got no doubt it's going to go to Chris Jordan. Not only because he was so influential as the general to the back line of Rovers, but just as a career ender, you couldn't possibly have a better swan song. And I know I'm being influenced by sentiment here, and I shouldn't be. And I'll smack myself on the forehead thrice for that. But he was the difference between the two teams, in my view.
Yeah, he was unbelievable, as I was saying earlier. Just pulling the strings. Warren Randall was also really good. But I think having a bit of experience outside him with Gary Collins and with Chris Jordan was... Gave him the freedom to play the way that he did. He was a little general at the back of the scrum. He was made a lot of the right decisions. Was really solid off the base and gave them a chance to get going forward. I think that the defense of College Rovers really was one of the big differences today. They defended well. They defended hard, and they really gave the Crusaders boys a go. And that, ladies and gentlemen, draws to a close our coverage of the 2015 Castle Murray Cup. I hope you enjoyed it as much as we did. It was an enthralling game of rugby with the Johnson College Rovers running out 53 points to 20 victors on a great day here in Durban. Thank you very much for tuning in, and we hope to see you all soon.
This is a great moment in rugby as the old Murray Cup, Castle Murray Cup, gets handed over to the captain of the victorious Rovers team, Gary Collins. So the Vice is collecting the new Murray Cup. Elton Cuthbert is going to now hand over that winner's check of 50,000 Rand to this all-conquering team from Johnson College Rovers. The knockout champions of 2015. There's a quick handshake, 50,000 Rand changes hands, and we're going to have the Rovers team to come up onto the podium now to enjoy this moment. The champions of the Castle Murray Cup for 2015, Johnson.